sins and griefs to bear.
Today's lesson, Gospels, forgiveness, comments about it. Yes, ma'am.
Even though it's titled forgiveness, then they talk about what do you believe in. So I'm sure I'll call that.
Yep, you're kind of picking up on.
Yes, I'm starting to look for that.
Well, and I'm not trying to turn us all into critics.
No, I just made a new title. I put signs of false teachings.
Okay.
I believe. Right. Yeah.
And I applaud this. And again, I'm not trying to turn you all into critics, but you know, this has been one of my main criticisms as we've gone through these lessons, is that oftentimes they're labeling the lesson that, as far as I'm concerned, it's mislabeled.
Mm-hmm. I also put how to be rooted.
Yes, you could do that.
Yeah.
If you were looking at the passages of Scripture, the first passage is on page 84. And of course, we're going to read through all of these. But if you look through that passage of Scripture, do you see the word forgiveness anywhere in there? Mm-hmm. No. The next page, page 85, down at the bottom is our next passage of Scripture. Do you see the word forgiveness there anywhere? Okay. So, you know, I'm kind of getting an impression here. The main theme of these passages of Scripture is not about forgiveness. Now, the last passage of Scripture, yeah, it does mention forgiveness. There in verse 13, He made you alive with Him and forgave us all our trespasses. So it finally does get around to mentioning forgiveness. But that is not what the main thrust of the lesson is. And I'm not going to go on to one of my characteristics.
I have one question.
Yes, ma'am.
How does the gospel forgive us? The gospel does not forgive us, not yet.
Well, that's true. But gospel literally means good news. The good news is that there is forgiveness, and I guess that's the connection that they're trying to make.
You know, that was my question. I didn't even know. I mean, I knew it wasn't in there, but.
Yeah, and I've always been told all of my life that gospel literally means good news.
Yeah.
Good news, good news, good news. I've never had it, seen it broken down to know the origins of the word. But the good news is that there is forgiveness. And with all of these lessons, the good news is there's power. The good news is goal. I'm going back to what it said in the opening part of our book. Forgiveness, freedom, lived relationships. You know, they try to put these things together, and I get it. You want to have organization, but at times I think that they do so at the expense of what the text is actually talking about. And as I said, with regard to the passages of Scripture today, only the third passage of Scripture deals with the issue of forgiveness. So the other two don't even deal with the subject of forgiveness. And I'll also say this. I've not been a fan, as you know, of when they put the headings over the verses of Scripture, the little one-word headings. You know, I just feel like that too many times those are open interpretation. What are you trying to get across here? But at any rate, we're not going to solve that. I'm encouraged to see that you're looking at it rather than just swallowing everything that's fed to you. And again, I'm not trying to turn you into critics, but what it says to me is that you're starting to pay attention to what the text actually says, as opposed to what they're just trying to say within the lesson. I will add this, and then we'll get into actually going through the verse. So many times they and I made this comment last week, even in the explanation of the verses, they get so caught up in giving the meaning of this word or this phrase or this verse of Scripture that it's disconnected from what the title is about. And I feel like that all of these things should be tied as much as possible back to what the title is, because that's the theme. That's the theme of the lesson. That's what we're trying to encourage people to embrace and learn from. Yes, Mary?
The first part, it's more about being aware of false teachers.
Exactly.
You know, don't be deceived by them.
It doesn't have anything to do with the gospel's forgiveness.
And then you have a turtle. No offense.
You know, last week they brought that to my attention. Said,
we were excited for this.
They said, we hope our mascot can be here.
And guess what?
Yes.
Oh, my.
At least Turtle takes everything, you know.
In stride.
Yeah.
But you'll notice that is a very big shell.
Yes.
I don't think he gets upset too bad.
No.
He knows we love him.
I love him.
Only at the steel game, though.
And for those that are watching on YouTube, we do have Turtle with us today. A lot of times he wants to come on Sunday, but they're at work. And for some reason, they've allowed him a couple times here recently to come to church. Maybe they felt like he needed it.
But this week, I'm off today, off tomorrow, but the rest of the week I'll be working.
Okay.
Like Tuesday, 9-5.
We don't need your schedule.
Wednesday and Thursday, 1-9. So Wednesday I will not be here.
Okay. Alright.
It's Friday, 11-7. And then Saturday, 12-8.
Okay. Well, we're glad you're here today. And we do love you, Turtle. For anybody out there on YouTube that thinks that we hate him, we don't. That's a sign that we do love him. And for the most part, you're right, Mary. He deals with it very well. In fact, I've heard, I don't know how true it is, I think his mother has even intimated as much. He thrives on it. It's one of those things that
he's special.
Get him over there. Yeah. Bring it on, he says. Bring it on.
I just gave you back some.
That's right. All right, so we'll look at the first passage of Scripture. And again, it doesn't really deal with forgiveness, but I will say this, if you want to be forgiven, you will have to continue in that relationship that you have with Jesus Christ. Jesus is the one that forgives. Yeah. And so I can make that application of the one word title for this passage of Scripture. You must, if you're going to get forgiven and remain forgiven, you have to be under the blood of Jesus Christ. He is the forgiver of our sins. He's the one that has paid the price. So, who would like to read this out loud, this first passage of Scripture? You want to read it, Mary? Thank you.
I am saying this, let's see, we'll start on.
You're good.
I am saying this so that no one will deceive you with arguments that sound reasonable. For I may be absent in the body, but I am with you in spirit, rejoicing to see how well ordered you are and the strength of your faith in Christ. So then, just as you have received Christ Jesus as Lord, continue to walk with him, being rooted and built up in him and established in the faith, just as you were taught, and overflowing with gratitude.
All right, very good. Of course, we've talked about this before. The Apostle Paul is in prison, most likely in Rome, and he's never met these people, but he is very concerned about them. He's apparently gotten some reports that there's things that are going on in the church that are of concern to him, and as we look at this verse of Scripture that you just read, Mary, he's concerned, apparently, from this fourth verse, concerned about these people being deceived. Have any of y'all ever been deceived? Those of you that are parents, did your children ever deceive you about something that had happened in your life?
No.
Did they always come forward and tell you the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth? Or did they perhaps twist the truth in order to protect their hides? You tell me.
They told us the truth 30 years later.
They told you the truth 30 years later.
It's never too late.
Of course, let me ask you this. Did we ever, it's easy to talk about them, did we ever deception is real, and sometimes it can have devastating consequences. I mean, my mind just went back, I don't know, 20 years. I guess it's been close to 20 years. Bernie Madoff.
Oh, yeah. The financial guy, right?
Yeah. That he scammed people out of all of that money. It was deception. So I'm not going to dwell on that, but I just want to focus on this verse of Scripture. The Apostle Paul is concerned because he understands there are people out there that are going to deceive you. And deception can have serious consequences, and I'm just bringing that up to you. Perhaps you've been snookered into something in the past. A salesman that came along and sold you a lemon.
Nowadays, we know that too. You can see things that look one way, you order them, and they're
and of course, I'm sure that what was partly on the Apostle Paul's mind is that I think that during his day, he thought that the Lord was going to return and that the Antichrist was going to be revealed. And one of the key features of the Antichrist is what? Deception. We hear on the radio or television all the time, if it sounds too good. What? It probably is. So be on your guard. And so he's concerned that there are people that are going to come into the church and they're going to have deceptive arguments. Now, I want us to broaden it because I'm not really worried about those things happening to us. But again, I think that the Word of God is addressing not just the things that are going on that day, but it's applicable to us today. In those days, of course, Christianity broke off of what religion? Jewish. So when Jesus was raised, was a Jew. Okay? So, let me ask you a question. Was Jesus a Jew? Did Jesus observe Jewish customs? Does the Bible say whether or not Jesus was circumcised? Yeah, remember his parents took him to the temple, you know, to do what was required of the law? Yeah. So he was circumcised. Okay. And had this issue of circumcision cropped up in any other churches that the Apostle Paul wrote to? Yeah. So you've got these Jewish people that came in and they say, you know what? You claim to be a follower of Jesus Christ. And Jesus was Jewish. And Jesus was circumcised. So you should be circumcised too. Does that sound reasonable? Is that what he says here? They're going to come across with arguments. They sound reasonable. They ask a question, did Jesus observe the Passover?
Yeah.
Not just with his disciples, but the Bible says when he was 12 years of age. That's what his parents had gone to Jerusalem for. Passover. And they were on their way back home. So if Jesus observed the Passover, do you think that Jesus wants us to observe the Passover? Careful here. See, this is the way that they came into the church. They would start to come along with reasonable arguments, and then all of a sudden people say, well, if I want to have a right relationship with God, I guess I need to do what Jesus did.
And it was hard for Paul because, figure, Paul was locked away. He wasn't with his church members.
He had probably never met these people.
No.
We don't have evidence that he ever visited this church. And so the Apostle Paul had seen what had happened at these other churches when they came in. For instance, the book of Philippians. That's the passage of scripture where he talks about the dogs. Beware of the dogs. And he's not talking about the ones that run through the neighborhood and forage through your garbage can. He's talking about the mutilators of the flesh. That's what he calls them. You know, they thought that this act on the flesh was somehow going to make them more right with God. The Apostle Paul makes it very clear there in Philippians chapter 3. It doesn't do anything. It's not what's done on the flesh. It's what takes place in the heart. He, in the third chapter of Philippians, he says, you know, I was a Hebrew of the Hebrews. I was from the tribe of Benjamin. I was circumcised on the eighth day. I was a Pharisee, for crying out loud. As far as the legalistic laws go, you know, I try to do them all. And then he goes on to say in that third chapter, but I considered all of those things as dung. They don't mean anything to God. What matters with God is being made right with God through faith in Jesus Christ. So the Apostle Paul is trying to warn this church. Look, I've seen what it's done in churches in the past. We had a similar thing that happened here within churches, and this is why you've got to take the Word of God and make broader application. Back in the 1970s, churches split all across the United States over what issue? C-H-A-R-I-S. What'd you say again, Betty?
Charismatic.
The charismatic movement.
Speaking in tongues.
Speaking in tongues. I don't know if anybody in this church was affected by it or not, but I'm not kidding you. It was something that led to deep divisions across the United States. What was being said? Well, people came into the church with, you know, their Bibles, and they said, those that have received the Spirit of God will speak in tongues. And they ignore the passages of Scripture that says that's a gift that not God doesn't give to everybody. There are different sorts of gifts, and He gives the gifts as He decides. And yet they came in with reasonable sounding arguments. They would take the Bible and they'd point to that and say, now if you haven't spoken tongues, I'm guaranteeing you right now, you don't have the Spirit of God. And if you don't have the Spirit of God, you're lost. And there were Christians that have been Christians all their life, that all of a sudden are thrown into a panic. I'm not speaking in tongues. I must be lost. And they prayed fervently, God, give me this gift. And God didn't give it. And they felt like, oh, I'm lost. I'm going to hell. I'm just saying, you've got to be careful within churches that somebody can come along with reasonable sounding arguments. And the Apostle Paul, even though he had never served at this church, he's concerned about their well-being. Because he understands that division will severely hurt a church, and all that it takes is just a little bit.
It's truth.
Yeah.
Legalism.
Well, legalism.
They mixed enough truth to make you believe things, and then they tell you something totally wrong.
You're right.
You've got to be
And I know that I mentioned last week in my message from the book of Jude about contending for the faith. And contending for the faith, it doesn't just mean that Jesus saves. It means standing up for what's right.
I think, too, you feel sometimes, you know, like if you listen to the some of the preachers on TV, say something completely not free, then, you know, you have that feeling that that's not the way it is. Then you turn it down. You don't listen to it before. I've done that.
You're right.
Yeah,
absolutely, and I applaud that. You better make sure that what you're listening to is being the truth. I'd started to say about last week, contending for the faith doesn't mean just believing that Jesus saves. Because the Jude writes in that passage of Scripture, there were godless people that came in and they were promoting immorality. You know, he talks about that in the book of Jude. And so the faith isn't just saying Jesus saves. It also means standing up for what's right and wrong in the eyes of God. And you and I have a responsibility to do what's right in the eyes of God. And we do have to guard ourselves. But also part of the message last week, I made a special emphasis about what we as Christians believe about Jesus Christ. We believe that Jesus Christ is God. But I also named off some other religions that don't.
They have good arguments too.
Well, I think I started last Sunday morning with the Jews. That was one of the things that really set them off. They were incensed by Jesus claiming to be God or even the Son of God. That was blasphemy. You remember how the high priest tore his robe and stuff? We don't need to listen to anything more. It's basically the same sort of mentality that goes on with the Muslims today if you mention anything derogatory about Muhammad. By the way, if you're ever captured by them, don't tell any of your Muhammad jokes. Because they really believe that Muhammad is the ultimate voice. I told you back in 1987 when I went through Nairobi and I saw the mosque there in downtown Nairobi, and across the front of the mosque it had inscribed in concrete, you know, in writing, "None to be worshipped but Allah, Muhammad is his prophet." That's why in these countries, buddy, that they ended up putting a cartoon of Muhammad, and the Muslim world just went absolutely, and you better never do anything against the Quran. But they reject the divinity of Jesus Christ. As I told you also last week about the Muslim that I saw down in New Mexico, and he said that Jesus was just like a prophet like Moses that could do miracles, like parting the Red Sea. So you can get, I'm only mentioning this because I'm trying to emphasize to you that religious groups also can enter your homes with fine sounding arguments. It's not just the Jews, it's not just the Muslims, it's the Mormons. They also reject the divinity of Jesus Christ, Jehovah's Witness. That's why their name says Jehovah. They focus upon God only. They don't see Jesus as being divine. And so there are these dangers, and this is what the Apostle Paul is trying to warn the church at Colossae. You've got to be on your guard that nobody comes in with fine-sounding arguments and begins to work on pulling you away from your belief in Jesus Christ.
They're persistent.
They are. We are followers of Jesus Christ, so don't come and try to take me away from Jesus. Hey, look, Jesus is the one who died. Jesus is the one that came back to life. Jesus is the one that said to Mary and Martha, said at least to Martha, "I am the resurrection and the life." I believe that resurrection comes from Jesus. He's the one that said in John 14:6, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. And no one comes to the Father but by me." So Paul is writing to this church of Colossae. He says, look, you need to make sure that when you get somebody there within your church, be aware. Be warned, there are those out there that are going to try to diminish your faith in Jesus Christ, and don't allow that to happen. He says that it's arguments that they sound reasonable. It's reasonable. You know, just like when I mentioned about Jesus observed Passover, so should we. I say that. I had a cousin here. That was probably over, then 20, 25 years ago, because it was right after maybe I came here, that she had gone to a church. That they started, this church started observing those Jewish festivals. And she pulled the verses of Scripture out, and it said in those verses of Scripture, these things should be observed forever. As you know, a lot of those Old Testament passages, that's what it said. And because we're not doing it, we're not receiving God's blessing. You see how it begins to mess with your mind? And the Apostle Paul says, look, folks, those festivals, they didn't make people right with God. That's what the Apostle Paul was saying to the church at Philippi. He says, look, I used to do all of that stuff, and I consider it worthless compared to knowing Jesus Christ my Lord. The only thing that I'm trusting in for my salvation is Jesus Christ, Jesus alone. Right? So the fifth verse says, I may be absent in body, but I'm with you in spirit. And his thoughts and his prayers were with him. He says, rejoicing to see how well ordered. So apparently it was a church that wasn't dealing with things like the Corinthian church. Corinthian church had the abuse of the Lord's Supper that was going on. And then there was also apparently within the church people speaking in tongues, and they didn't have a translator that was present, and so on and so forth. So apparently the church at Colossae was well ordered. They were disciplined. They were kind of doing what they should. And he says, in the strength of your... Please rejoice in how well ordered you are in the strength of your faith in Christ Jesus. So I'm happy about that. I just don't want to see you lose what you've been given. So then, just as you have received Christ Jesus as Lord, here's where the title for this passage, this whole block, comes from. Continue to walk in Him. What does it mean to walk with Jesus Christ? Follow Him. Go where Jesus goes. Do what Jesus does. Approve what Jesus approves of. Turtle usually at this point raises his hand and he says, wristband.
WWDD.
What would Jesus do? Exactly right.
And that was a movie, though, also a name of it, too.
In His Steps. Is the
WWJD.
Yeah.
It's a good movie too as well.
Once again, and I know, preacher, keep your mouth shut. Don't stir up trouble. But it's just absolutely amazing to me, people that call themselves Christians and have voted for the president that we currently have in the White House that is fully in favor of abortion at all stages. Not just in favor of that, but in favor of homosexuality and transgenderism. And I could go down a long list of things. And let me tell you what, as a follower of Jesus Christ, you've gone AWOL if you're supporting that. Amen. And in fact, if you will go over to the little book of 1 John, John is very outspoken. He says, if you claim to know Jesus Christ and you are walking in sin and you're supporting it, you're lying. You don't know Jesus Christ. I hope people say, oh, you're going to stir up trouble. I'm just telling you the truth, folks, and that's part of staying connected to Jesus Christ. You begin to allow things to creep into your life to Jesus Christ, and let me tell you, it will go from bad to worse. Because Satan is never happy with just a toehold within your life. Yes, Turtle?
What I was saying about the WJD movie. That was the people in town was kind of didn't know that it did some of the stuff kind of creep in their life though. Mm-hmm. When that guy came, the stranger came along, it kind of, they sit thinking, oh no, we gotta get away from those bad things, go back to what would Jesus do.
Absolutely. And the church really needs to come back to that because, as I said, this has been a big problem, even within our convention, folks. And I wasn't glad, I wasn't sad to see him leave. We had as head of the Ethics and Religious Liberty Commission that just recently resigned here several months ago, left the convention because he continued to get flack. He supported Biden with all of these policies and that sort of stuff. He was the head of the Ethics and Religious Liberty Commission. And there were a lot of churches within the Southern Baptist Convention that said, you know what, if this is what the leadership of the SBC is supporting, we're no longer going to send our gifts into the convention. Yeah. And let me tell you what, the church has a responsibility to operate under the lordship of Jesus Christ. What would Jesus do?
Amen.
And anybody wants to come on and say, well, Jesus just wants us all to be friends. No, Jesus came to do away with sin. And you will never be strong in your relationships as long as there is sin in the camp. I guarantee it. So he says, you need to continue to walk in Christ. You need to understand that you are accountable to Jesus Christ. You are to represent Jesus Christ. You are to be the presence of Jesus Christ on this earth. And there is no way, and I don't mean to get hung up on this, there is no way that Jesus would stand there in the operating room of one of these abortion clinics while they chop a baby up in pieces and Jesus say, this is good. Absolutely no way. Absolutely no way. And you could carry it to these other items as well. Jesus would not say, this is good. In fact, we've been given a clear indication from the Word of God about the homosexuality issue from the story of Sodom and Gomorrah. God absolutely destroyed that. They're still looking for those cities. They think that they found them, but God so utterly destroyed them. Man, you couldn't find a trace of them. And you and I do well to understand God has revealed to us what He's like. And as I've said to you before, don't mess around with God. God is going to hold us accountable. So He says, continue to walk in Christ, being rooted in Christ. What does that mean? I am not concerned about what the rest of the world says. I am drawing everything that I need in order to live and survive from Jesus Christ. I don't care what our government comes along and says. What does Jesus say? Jesus is Lord. He is the one that we're accountable to. Not just rooted in Him, but built up in Him. That means, Lord, I want to become stronger in these areas. I don't want to become weaker. I want to be built up. I want to know what it is to take a stand for the things that are right, regardless of what the cost is. I'll tell you, there may be heavy costs for us to pay in our walk with the Lord. But you and I will find the strength that we need as we remain attached to Jesus Christ. I'm thinking back to the video that we watched about the guy that had gone up to the missionaries up in China. And he found a compound of them. There were like 120 of them there in that compound. The Insanity of God, if any of you have ever watched that video. It's about a missionary. It was a Southern Baptist missionary, and it talks about how the Lord had worked in him, his wife's life. He eventually was going into these areas of the world where there were persecuted Christians to find out what it was that made them so strong. And one of the three trips that they focused on that segment of the movie, he had gone up to China. He landed over in some city in China, then got in a vehicle and went 20 hours up in the northern part of China. Had no idea where he was, went to a compound, and there in this compound he found like 120 believers. And he said that when he went there, he felt, I guess in some ways, totally inadequate to be speaking to these people. Because almost all of them had spent, they didn't really consider you a true follower of Jesus Christ unless you'd spent 3 years in prison. Have you ever stopped to think about what it would be like to spend 3 years of your life locked up? Abused, tortured? That's why the Apostle Paul says you need to be not only rooted in Jesus Christ, you need to be built up in Jesus Christ. And you get built up by standing strong with Jesus Christ. When you begin to depart from Jesus Christ, you are going to weaken in your commitment. And there's the danger that you will falter in the difficult times. Established in the faith. That's why I applaud y'all for coming to church. You know, you're trying to become established. I want to be solid as a Christian, and unless these people at Colossae, unless they stood strong, they would never, you know, retain their identity. They would kind of fall by the wayside. The Apostle Paul, at the same time that he was sending this letter to the church of Colossae, what other church nearby did he send a letter to? He sent a separate letter to them because he said, I want you to get a hold of their letter, read their letter, and I want to take your letter and give it to them so they can read it. Do you remember what other church was nearby at the time? L-A-O. Laodicea. Laodicea. What do you remember about the church of Laodicea? Where do you read about the church of Laodicea? Well, it comes with seven messages to the churches in the book of Revelation. The church at Laodicea was neither hot nor cold. They were lukewarm. And God says what? Because of your lukewarmness, spit you out.
Spit you out.
In other words, you're going to be shut down. And what it says in that passage of Scripture too, if I'm not mistaken, said you folks think that you're okay, that you can see, and that you're, you know, so and so. He says, but you're really naked, you're blind, you're really sick. They seem to be fitting in with everything around them, and they thought that they were okay, but in the eyes of God, he says, look, because you're lukewarm, I'm going to spit you out. What does that mean? I understand it to mean God says, I'm going to shut your church down. That was the message to all of these seven churches, you know. You've been given a candlestick with a light in it that symbolizes my presence, and if you're not careful, I'll snuff it out. So, why don't we hear anything about the church of Laodicea? Got snuffed out. It's a warning to us. It's a warning. Be passionate. That's one of my main concerns for not only the churches of today, but for the past several years, we've seen this waning love for God. If you ask every person out there, do you love God? Oh, yeah, I love God. Yeah. And he says, I want you to be established in faith just as you were taught and overflowing with gratitude. I know I spent too much time on this one. Let's look at the second passage of Scripture. Who would like to read this one out loud? Will you find? Thank you.
Be careful that no one takes you captive through philosophy and empty deceit based on human
tradition,
based on the elements of the world rather than Christ, but for the entire fullness of God's nature dwells bodily in Christ, and you have been filled by him who is the head over every ruler and authority.
Thank you. Once again, he's reporting this, or he is basically saying, I'm warning you, be careful that nobody tricks you, deceives you, takes you captive through philosophy. Philosophy means the love of wisdom. Oh, I think I can get smarter on this. That's basically what the word philosophy means. And empty deceit, there's that word deception again, based on human tradition. Oh, this is what we've always done and we think that we need to do. So don't get sucked into that based on the elements of the world rather than Christ. Key verse here, verse 9. For the entire fullness of God's nature dwells bodily in Christ. And I'm making special emphasis, Colossians chapter 1 says, he is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. So this passage of Scripture, again, is speaking of the divinity of Jesus Christ. You know, you get somebody who says, well, you need to focus on God and need to downplay Jesus here just a little bit. You're giving Jesus way too much credit. The Apostle Paul saying, no. The entire fullness of God's nature dwells bodily in Christ. You see the fullness of God. Jesus says, you know, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. So this is why he's telling him, look, you hold on to Christ. Don't let anybody take you away from Christ. You are Christians, and you wear his name, Christ, little Christ. You've been filled by him who is the head over every ruler and authority. So that I won't take any more time on that. Let's get to what the title of the lesson was about, forgiveness. Who would like to read this last passage out loud? Sheila, will you? Thank you.
Remember, you were also circumcised in him with a circumcision not done with hands, by putting off the body of flesh in the circumcision of Christ, when you were buried with him in baptism, in which you were also raised with him through faith in the working of God, who raised him from the dead, and when you were dead in trespasses and in the uncircumcision of your flesh, he made you alive with him and forgave all our trespasses. He erased the certificate of debt with his obligations that was against us and opposed to us, and has taken it away by nailing it to the cross. He disarmed the rulers and authorities and disgraced them publicly. He triumphed over them in him.
Very good. So this part does at least talk about the forgiveness. Here's what he says. You were circumcised in Christ, how? With a circumcision not done with hands. What's that talking about? I think Jeremiah the prophet talked about a circumcision of the heart, meaning that there is this covering over your heart that you are not responsive to God. And says, remove that covering from your heart so that your heart is now obedient to God. It is, and again, the Apostle Paul would say, like with Abraham, when God gave the promise to Abraham that God would make of him a great nation and he would bless him, had Abraham been circumcised yet? No. But Abraham was not circumcised at that point. He was, and so here's the point that he would try to make in other places. God gave the promise to Abraham not based on what had happened in the flesh. God gave the promise to Abraham based upon Abraham's faith in God's willingness to do it. Later, he went ahead and got himself circumcised. But he received the blessing from God before he was circumcised. Without any circumcision. And the Apostle Paul would end up saying, guess what? The same is true with us. Now, I don't believe we need to go back and get circumcised because the circumcision doesn't do anything except
hurt.
Yeah. So, anyhow, he says, look, you were circumcised in Christ with a circumcision that wasn't done with hands by putting off the body of flesh and the circumcision of Christ. When you were buried with him in baptism, that's where we kind of get this expression of buried with Christ in baptism. You know, we're symbolizing a death, a burial, and a resurrection when we baptize somebody. In which you were also raised with him through faith in the working of God, who raised him from the dead. When you were dead in your trespasses and in the uncircumcision of your flesh, he made you alive with him, and what? There's the word. Finally, today's lesson. He forgave us. Your forgiveness came through Christ. How did he do it? He talks about this later on, that he erased the certificate of debt, this obligation that was against us and opposed us. He took them away by nailing our sins to the cross.
That's how he got saved, wasn't
that? That's right. He came by faith. Lord, when you come into your kingdom, remember me. And Jesus says, yes, today thou shalt be with me in paradise. Our sins have been paid for through Christ's death on the cross. That's why Christ is so central to our believing. Nobody else has died for our sins. And for a person to say, well, there's not really a death that needs to take place, that's not according to the Word of God. God says, the wages of sin, and that comes from back in the book of Genesis, where God said to Adam and Eve, in the day you sin, thereof you shall surely die. There is a death penalty for sin. And we believe that that death penalty was paid. Jesus took and paid it. I'm giving my life. I'm dying on this cross for you. And that's why the Apostle Paul is trying to get across these folks there in Colossae. Look, everything about who you are and your eternal destiny revolves around this person of Jesus Christ. So make sure that you don't allow anybody or anything to come into your life and pull you away from Christ. He is the centerpiece of all that we are and all that we stand for. And you and I have a responsibility not only to stand up for him and with him, but help others to understand what he teaches, that we will be representative of the person whose name we bear. Any final questions or comments? I know that we kind of didn't get into the whole forgiveness, but we are forgiven through Christ. Well, let's have a closing prayer. Father, as we get ready to leave, we just ask your continued blessings upon us and our time that we study together. Help us to remain faithful to your Son. And remember, Father, that we owe everything to him. Bless this lesson to our lives. Bless now the service to follow. Have your will and your way in each person's heart and life. And use us to do your will. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.